we've got Michael Macaulay, direct from New Zealand, keen footy supporter, and he's going to take us on a lovely journey. Thank you, Michael.
Thank you very much, Renee. Thank you very much for calling me special. My mum thinks I'm special. And my dad's always said I was special, but I think for very different reasons to the ones my mum outlined. I'd like to thank Renee. I'd like to thank Laura for it. That was absolutely awesome. That was really inspiring. Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank everyone for coming out here today. Up until about half an hour ago, I didn't quite realise there was going to be quite so many people here for this event, which is fantastic, but obviously it does have potential downsides, one of which is, of course, someone's nicked my notes there, by the way. Has anyone got my notes? Oh, well, not to worry. We don't need them. Well, we'll find out. We'll find out how special I am, won't we, eh? But one of the downsides is, unfortunately, because there's so many people here, inevitably, there's going to be some people who just don't like what I'm going to say. You know, no matter what I do or how I engage with you guys, there's some people just not going to like it. So if you're one of these people, 10, 15 minutes in, and you just think this is terrible, remember, it's not my fault, all right? It's just the ineffable laws of probability. You're just victims of maths. That's all it is. I'm very proud of my heritage as well, and although I'm from New Zealand, you can probably, the eagle-eared among you can detect I'm not actually from New Zealand. I'm originally from the northeast of England, a place called Teesside. The main town is called Middlesbrough. I don't know if you know Middlesbrough. But for the people who don't know Middlesbrough, it's an absolute paradise. It is a Shangri-La, a positive utopia. And it was a gigantic wrench for me to move from there to New Zealand. For the people who do know Middlesbrough, don't tell the others. Right? It's our secret. But of course, one thing that is cultural heritage is that Teesside actually has quite a lot of connections with Australia. I don't know if you know that. James Cook is from Teesside. Now, I realise he's a bit of a mixed bag nowadays, so I'm not going to emphasise that too much. But anyone here from New South Wales? Anyone here from Sydney? Put your hands up. We built your bridge for you. Thank you very much. You're welcome. That's from Middlesbrough. True story from the Dorman Long Company. And also, if there's anyone who remembers the great 70s Australian exploitation classics, films such as Alvin Purple and Stalk and all those marvellous films, Tim Burstall, who directed those films, he was from Stockton, from about 2 miles away from my mum's house. So there you go. Ausploitation, you're welcome to that as well. So I'm very proud of that. Now, this is the presentation I'm going to give today. Building integrity, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And there's just a couple of things I want to say about it before I start. The first is that I'm not really here to try and tell you anything that you don't already know. I'm certainly not here to try and teach you anything or things like that. Because when it comes to ethics and integrity, you're all already the experts in that yourselves. Is there any psychologists in the room? Could you put your hand up? They never do. I know you'll be there. I know you're trying to play mind games already. Typical. Well, psychologists here, you can back me up on this. There are three, well, more than three, but three real important things that most of us, not all of us, but most of us are fairly sure about in terms of our own self-image. The first is that we all secretly think we're slightly better looking than the average person. We don't, it's true, we're true. The studies, thousands of studies back this up. We don't necessarily think that we're gorgeous. Some of you will, of course. But we do tend to think we're above average in terms of physical attractiveness. The other thing we tend to think about ourselves is that we tend to think we're much funnier than other people and that we have a quirky sense of humour. And we tell ourselves that because no one laughs at our jokes. So we put it down to the fact our sense of humour just a bit better than everybody else's. They just don't get it. But the third thing we tend to think about ourselves is that we have a fairly strong and robust moral sense. I'd be very surprised if anyone here woke up this morning, was getting ready, looked themselves in the mirror and thought, do I have an understanding of what is right and wrong today? Of course not. You all have very good internal moral codes, and you've had them for a long, long time. So for that reason, there's not much I can actually say that will be of huge benefit to you about your own personal morality and integrity. So what I'm going to try and do today is just talk through some of the issues that you may wrestle with, that you may wrestle with in a professional capacity, maybe even a personal capacity. Just a couple of notes about the title. It's The Good, The Bad and The Ugly. That's obviously just a tie-in with the classic film of the same name. Really, it's not ugly, it's kind of messy. It should really be The Good, The Bad and The Messy. And just one other thing, I'm actually going to do it in reverse order. Because I thought if you did it in that order, you'll end on a real negative, won't you? You don't want that on a day out, do you? You've had a nice lunch, and then you get some lunatic at the front going, oh, everything's terrible. Yeah, you don't want that. it's a Friday, we want to go home happy. So I'm going to do the messy, the bad, and the good. I hope that's okay with everyone. So without further ado, my first anecdote of the day is about this gentleman. Now, this gentleman is a fellow called Ray Mallon. I don't know if you've heard of Ray Mallon. Some of you may well have done. When Tony Blair became Prime Minister, he put through some legislation to say that towns and cities in England, and not Scotland, I believe, but England and Wales, could vote on whether or not they wanted an elected mayor. Very few cities and towns have done. There's still less than 20. But some cities and towns did. Leicester, Bristol, Birmingham. I think Bristol, actually. I might be wrong about that. But certainly Hartlepool and also Middlesbrough. And Ray Mallon became Middlesbrough's very first ever elected mayor, and he was re-elected three further times, so he had four terms. He's no longer mayor. Now, Ray Mallon made his name as Chief Superintendent of Cleveland Police. And he made his name because he became famously nicknamed Robocop, because he instituted what was called the zero tolerance policy to crime. Now, I don't want to make light of this, but I'm not sure what a non-zero tolerance policy to crime would look like, because I believe the police always do arrest people. But I might just be wrong about that. But he instituted the zero tolerance system, and he made a big splash, a lot of headlines. But then there was a corruption investigation into Cleveland Police, known as Operation Lancet. And it was discovered that Chief Superintendent Mallon faced 14 counts of various corruption charges. Never went to a criminal court, but these were all police charges, work charges. And he admitted them all 14. Yes, I did them. Why did he admit them? Well, his stated case was he admitted them so that he could have a clean slate in running to be an elected mayor. Now, let's think about this for a second. How messy could it possibly be when admitting to 14 counts of corruption is essentially your platform for a democratic election, which is a very successful one? Well, it's very messy for a number of reasons, because we assume that trust is a good thing, and I'll be returning to this theme later. We assume that we want our politicians to be able to have confidence in them and that they have integrity. One of the recommendations in the report, I believe it is about whether or not people with criminal convictions or corruption convictions should be able to have contracts and various things like that. Could be said about democratic elections as well. But what it also does go to show is possibly trust doesn't matter at all. It's a very messy business. It's not straightforward. So I just wanted to start with that story. Some of the many reasons integrity and ethics is very messy is because it is beset by paradoxes. I've put a couple of links up there for people who are interested in this, but the first link is to a very recent, I think only a couple of months ago, publication by Harvard Business School about toxic workers and how actually it's a very effective strategy to be very badly behaved at work. You'd be very successful. Some of you probably already know that, don't you? Some of the people you probably work with, you think, yeah, I've known that for years, actually, Mickey. But interestingly, what this report also found was that actually toxic workers tend to be much more productive. Much more productive. Now, obviously, it's not that straightforward. The report also found that their productivity may be higher, but the quality of their work isn't as good. So, you know, there is a balancing out process. But it's not as straightforward to say that toxic workers have a bad impact on things. Well, yes, they do. But they also can have very successful impacts and very positive impacts, and that's a tricky one to get your head behind. Another messy thing is the idea of corporate psychopathy. The corporate psychopath, the person who is so relentless and so selfish and so instrumental in their views that, again, they actually become extremely successful. And the messy thing there isn't just that happens. We all, to some extent, according to people like Robert Hare, who create checklists of psychopathic tendencies. These are personal characteristics. It's a disorder. It's not a mental illness as such. It's a personality disorder. And we all exhibit them. We all exhibit some degree of psychopathic tendency in certain ways. But it's when we exhibit all 20 all the same time, that's when, you know, we've got a real problem. And obviously, there's very few of those far in between. But many of the things that you'll find that are connected with the idea of the corporate psychopath, you'll also find connected with the idea of a very successful leader. The whole notion of the transformative, big style, kind of charismatic leader, I know that's not as fashionable as it was a few years ago, but it's still around, isn't it? We're still encouraged in business schools and in management schools to be leaders with impact, make a change, make a mark. leave a legacy. And a lot of the kind of the behaviours associated with that are also associated with these really, really, really negative traits too. And to make it even messier, there's just some more broad and general paradoxes. The whole notion of integrity is very, very, very messy indeed. I can't speak on your behalf, but I'm going to guess that most people around these tables have an idea of what integrity is. And that idea is probably along the lines of that integrity is behaving in a manner consistent with your beliefs and to behave consistently throughout that as well. So you'll do what you say, and you'll live your values and you'll live your principles, and there won't be a disconnect between the two. Is that roughly what you understand by personal integrity? It's the most common definition. Well, of course, that's all well and good if your values are worthy. But if your values aren't, and if your values are very, very negative, then ascribing to them and living to them can have a terrible impact on people. A really terrible impact on people. And it leads us to one of the other, not quite paradoxical, but certainly messy areas, that although we, every single one of us at these tables, myself at the lectern, we all have a firm and fixed idea of our ethical codes and our moral beliefs, they shift. We have this idea in our head of moral values as being universal and unchanging and set in stone, and they're not. And they shouldn't be. And if they are, you should reconsider them. You think about our lifetimes, you think about the last 10 years, you think about the last 20 years, you think of the differences we hold in our beliefs and our social values when it comes to all sorts of different areas. I'm not going to go into them here. But they've changed for the better. I am so glad that commonly held beliefs in the media, on TV, among my peer groups, among our political leaders, when I was growing up in the 70s and the 80s, I'm glad they're gone, quite frankly. So the whole point about ethics and morality and integrity in particular is, even though we hold firm ideas, and that's a good thing, we need to have a constant state of kind of recollection and reflection about them. We have to constantly test and investigate them. And that's not easy, having those conversations. It's not easy. It's not easy when it comes to things like corruption as well. Yet another area in which things are a little bit messy, and I'm going to kind of talk now about a specific piece of research that I did a couple of years back. Just before I do, does anybody have any experience about working in corrections or in the prison service? No? Really? Okay. I'm not asking if you've been to prison. Obviously. Obviously not. Well, I did some work on corruption in the British Corrections Service a few years ago. And it was no surprise to find that there are quite a lot of different types of problems. But the messy area was that there were different, entirely different groups of problems all working at the same time. So as you see here, I've put up that there are individual drivers, environmental drivers, and systemic drivers when it comes to corruption. And it comes to the idea of organisational culture and an ethical culture. You'll find these groups of drivers all the time. Anyone who works in somewhere where there's a toxic and ethical culture, I am sure this will resonate with you. There are all sorts of reasons why people in the corrections service engage in misconduct and corrupt acts. A lot of them are terrified. They get threatened, and their families get threatened into smuggling things in or turning a blind eye to certain activities or whatever it might be. A huge number of people engaged in misconduct in the correction service aren't prison officers, they're ancillary workers, they're social workers, janitors, teachers, those kind of things, librarians. They get coerced into things. Some of them are dissatisfied. Some of them just don't like the working conditions, particularly we've found in private prisons. I don't know if that has any impact in Australia. A lot of them just have a little bit of greed about them. They just want a little bit more money. There's all sorts of different reasons. All sorts of different reasons. But aligned with those are the environmental factors. Prisons, of course, are closed systems. Very few people get in. Very few people get out. And when you get in, there's a specific culture that you work within. And when you're in a closed system, it's far more likely for things to go wrong, far more likely for things to get toxic, because you build up your own ways of doing things. It's a classic thing, isn't it? That's not what we do around here. We do it like this. You get people coming in and they'll expect some training, they'll expect some mentoring. What they actually get is indoctrination into a certain system, a certain way of behaving, a certain belief system. And that's very, very difficult to shake off. One of the problems in the correction service, certainly in Britain, I'm only speaking about Britain, is as well, we have an extraordinarily high amount of people within that closed system who are brilliant at manipulation. Absolutely brilliant at it. Some of them, that's why they're there. And they're very good at getting people and creating trust, making people seem like they're friends. And being able to get the way to actually get people to behave in ways that they would never have done so otherwise. But more difficult of all are the systemic problems. Now, in the UK, the two main performance measures that are used to see how successful a prison is being run are A, number of attempted escapes, and B, the number of outbreaks of violence within the prison itself. Now, what's happened over the last 20 years in Britain is that organised crime has become more and more prevalent. With organised crime, you'll find more corruption all over the place. And you'll find that key performance indicators such of those kinds, the violence and the attempted escapes, have gone right down in Britain. Why? Because corruption enables people to get on with their own criminal empires in jail. They don't need to try and escape anymore. You smuggle in several tablets and laptops, people can do what they want. You can run whole empires, it's quite straightforward. And there's other perverse incentives as well. Again, this is just an anecdote, but we spoke with one of the former chief inspectors of prisons, and he told us a story about the very first inspection he did. And he went into a cell, and there was a prisoner there, and he had 20 or 25 certificates on his wall. And the inspector said, "Oh, what are these for?" And the guy went, "Oh, mandatory drug testing, sir. I've tested clean of drugs for the last 20 months. And the inspector went, "Oh, that's fantastic. Congratulations." And the guy went, "Not really. They know for a fact I've never taken them in my life." Now, obviously, I'm not saying they really did know that. That's just his view. But it could well be that the perverse incentives of performance management lead people to massage the figures, lead people to measure the things they know are going to be successful, but to turn an absolute blind eye to when those measures could be working against the performance that they're actually there to help and to get along with to start off with. What was the response, by the way, to this research that we did? Well, the government decided that its response would be to close down the anti-corruption unit. true story. They got rid of the chief exec. It's not funny, really. They got rid of the chief executive, a great guy called John Podmore, and they also, they didn't get rid of it, but they downgraded it. It used to be an independent CPU, a corruption prevention unit, and they actually brought it back within the ministry, and there's only three people working for it now. Now, again, I've not done any research subsequently, so I don't know if things have got better or worse, but it was an odd reaction, I think, an unusual reaction, and that's maybe because people don't want to acknowledge the truth. People want to live with the myth, and it is a myth, that corruption in Britain's prisons is about family members smuggling things in and smuggling things out, and that's just not true. It's not true. So we're moving into the bad now. And one of the other kind of more negative aspects of looking at ethics integrity is that solutions we think are reliable can be quite counterintuitive. This is a very common, is anyone familiar with this? This is the common equation for how to build trust. Credibility plus reliability plus intimacy. It's why you shouldn't trust me. You don't know how credible I am. You have no idea how reliable I am. We've certainly never been intimate until now. This isn't really that intimate, is it? Certainly not for Middlesbrough, I'll tell you. But you can see how this works, can't you? You know, people have, I theoretically have a credible background. You've seen my little mini biog. I'm presumably reliable because, you know, Renee's seen me before, so, you know, I've someone's vouching for me here. And hopefully, I'm creating some form of intimacy by trying at least, I don't know how successful I'm being, to be at least kind of like interesting. But the bad thing is, of course, that this comes down to simple technique, doesn't it? If we know this, we can reduce trust to simple technique. And so we go from things that might be counterintuitive to actually counterproductive. Another thing that's counterintuitive is that one of the things I think most of us assume is that, and again, psychology would have been very helpful to back me up on this, is that if we want people to trust us, we're nice to them. We do things for them. We're friendly to them. We're helpful. We do them favours. Actually, the more effective way of building interpersonal trust is getting other people to do favours for you. You get someone to do you a favour. Don't lend someone a book. Borrow one off them. Don't offer someone a lift. Get a lift off someone. Something small scale. And it works for a number of reasons. One, because if you ask for a favour, then you're putting yourself in a more vulnerable position. Not necessarily in a big way, but in a, you know, you're opening yourself up to, I need something, I have a lack, I need something. Number two, because there's an implication of reciprocity, and again, that doesn't have to be explicit, But if I ask for a favour, there's an implied reciprocity that I'll give something back. And number three, because it makes people feel nice about themselves, it makes people feel good. Has anyone come across this before, by the way? So I'm not just... I see a nod. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Excellent. It's like the world's weirdest auction there, wasn't it? But the reason we know this exists isn't just because we've done countless experiments on it. It's because people like this have demonstrated it. Do you know who that guy is? That's Ted Bundy, my friends. The deranged killer who was so grotesque that the actual term serial killer was coined by the FBI just to describe him. The expression serial killer didn't exist before the mid-70s to describe Ted Bundy. And this is exactly what he used to do. One of the many ruses he did to lure his victims was he would go to various university campuses, college campuses, and he'd have a plaster cast on his arm, sometimes on his like fake one, of course. He'd have a fake plaster and be carrying books. And he'd see his victim, and obviously there'd be the environmental factors there as well, isolated areas, so on and so forth. And he would drop the books, or the pile of papers or whatever he had, and he'd say, oh, can you just come and help me? I'm really, really sorry about this. And the person would obviously, oh, yeah, I've got a poor fellow there. He's vulnerable. He's credible. He's got a sling on. I'll come and help. And they'd go over and he'd smash them over the back of the head with a lead pipe or whatever he hit them with and take them off in his car. And I don't need to say any more. Exact same technique, my friends. That's quite bad, I think. I think that's quite worrying. I'm not even going to look because I'll be able to see it on your faces. Anyone here who's been involved in an emotional relationship where you've had your heart broken and you've been absolutely cheated, you trusted that person, didn't you? Didn't do you any good, did it? Unfortunately. It didn't, did it? Now, we're launching the very first ever, I think it's the first ever anyway, so forgive me if I'm wrong, I've not been able to find another one, political trust report in New Zealand at the end of this month. We're getting the results in next week, and I'm confident I roughly know what they're going to be. They're roughly going to say, we don't like MPs, but our MP's good. Don't really trust councils, but our councillor's great. That's what they'll roughly say. If they like other... No, that's what they'll say, because you're more intimate with your particular MP and your particular councillor. There's that kind of personal relationship there. And I'm kind of expecting them to say that. But one of the things I'm going to question in the future, and it comes back to the Ray Mallon argument, is just how much do we need to trust politicians anyway? I mean, really... Is it a good thing? Politicians would love us to trust them, then they can do anything they want. Wouldn't it be great if we just actually say, you know, maybe we shouldn't trust people? I'm not saying we should distrust them. We shouldn't go around trying to find problems. But actually having that healthy skepticism might not be a bad thing. Really? What's wrong with it? Just throwing that out there. Anyway, this is a very... How am I doing for time, Renee? That's okay. 8 minutes, sir, thank you. All right, it's a bit nebulous, isn't it? I'll just throw a bread roll at you when you have to get off. All right, I'll keep this one. It wouldn't be the first time either. I'll keep this one quick. You probably already know this story. Now, Tony Blair, you'll remember him. Good old Tone, honest Tony. Told a lot of things, said a lot of things, some of which we now think probably only had a patina of truth among it. Possibly exaggerated a few things. Weapons of mass destruction, etc., etc., etc. But one of the things he got caught with his proverbial pants down was about this fella. Jackie Milburn, used to be Newcastle United's centre-forward, legendary footballer, legendary centre-forward. Now, personally, being from Middlesbrough, I should have known straight away that Tony Blair couldn't necessarily be trusted because he was a Newcastle fan. You can't trust him. But Tony said that one of his cherished childhood memories, again, apologise if you already know this story, one of his cherished childhood memories was watching... Jackie Milburn from the while he was sat in the Gallagher end, the famous Gallagher end at Newcastle St James Park, watching him score all these goals. And someone said, actually, that's difficult to have any credibility to that story, Tony, because there was no seats in that part of the ground until the late 80s. And I thought, oh, well, yeah, it's just an expression, isn't it, saying I'm sat watching it. But then someone said, actually, Tony, Jackie Milburn had retired before you ever went to Newcastle. You never saw him play once. He'd never even seen it. And so this made people question poor Tony Blair a little bit, because it's all right for politicians to gloss over a few things occasionally. But for someone to talk about their cherished childhood beliefs in such a fake and fraudulent... Well, that's a whole new level of mendacity, isn't it? Really? Has anyone heard that story? Never heard that. It's still very popular. Nearly as popular as when Tony Blair and Peter Mandelson went to Hartlepool and they did a little run, they went to a fish shop. and they got some mushy peas and they came out and apparently said, this guacamole tastes funny. But I don't know if that's true. The real kicker to this story is not that Tony Blair may or may not have lied. It's that actually this very nice looking fella is a guy called Keith Topping. He was a reporter for a local newspaper who has gone on record countless times as explaining he made up that entire story about Tony Blair. He made it up. Tony Blair never claimed to have watched Jackie Milburn. He never claimed to have gone to these particular football matches. He never claimed that they were his cherished childhood memories. And yet in Britain, everyone still believes that Tony Blair told the story about Jackie Milburn, even though they now know it's not true. And you know why? Because it's more credible that he would have lied about it. His credibility is so low, it's actually more credible that he wouldn't have been honest. So again, when that comes to the idea of thinking of this trust quotient that you build up, it makes things a little bit difficult. Another thing you could ask, and this relates directly to the report, I don't have time to go into this now as well, is when we talk about credibility and reliability, what about the evidence that we have? The report that you've got in front of you constantly cites Transparency International CPI, Corruption Perception Index, and that's a great piece of work. But I think even Transparency International are honest enough to say it's only a proxy measure. Why? Because actually trying to measure real corruption is incredibly difficult because you're always trying to find things that aren't there, that are hidden away. You look at conviction rates tell you nothing because most people don't get convicted. And the people who do get convicted, certainly in the UK and America, don't get convicted on corruption. You get convicted on something else that's easier to prove. So Section 4 of the Fraud Act in Britain, for example, is a classic one. UK Bribery Act 2010, I'm sure you've heard about that. The world's most stringent corruption. It hasn't led to any arrests, has it? Half a dozen? All low level? Has it brought in any big guns? Of course not. Of course not. So perception indexes are useful, but they are only a proxy measure. And of course, you can interpret them in a number of ways. Since I've moved to New Zealand, we've gone from number one in the world to number four. So we're plummeting down the rankings, which either means I'm doing a terrible job or a very good one. And you need a sympathetic audience to try and persuade them of the second one. Because that's our transparency paradox, isn't it? When we make things more transparent, you might actually find out just how bad it is. An initial reaction might be, oh my God, stop finding these things out because we don't want to admit that things are as bad as they are. When really, it's actually far better that at least we know them and we can do something to tackle the problem. So when it comes to evidence on corruption, take everything with a pinch of salt, because you have to. Another thing that is really kind of difficult, and I've probably only got 4 minutes now, so I'm going to have to really race through this, is that Michael Johnson wrote a fantastic book a few years ago called The Syndromes of Corruption. And essentially what he said was, there's a huge bias, cultural bias in studies of corruption that most people think it's a developing nation problem. And of course that's garbage. You know it, I know it. What we do though, in our developed Western nations, is we kind of tie it all up in things that look respectable. We call it influence markets, the trading and selling of influence. And what we actually do is we not just legalize these things, we've lionized them as certain industries. So, for example, I won't talk about this because I don't have time, but you might see this, lobbying. This is directly from the Age, how the rise of lobbying. That's essentially one form of buying and selling influence. Not to say lobbying is a necessarily terrible thing. Lobbying is a very important industry. No one would say that people shouldn't have advocacy groups working for them. But some of the relationships between lobbying groups and some of the secrecy that surrounds them, certainly in the UK and New Zealand, not very helpful. Nepotism, patronage, public trust. Patronage and nepotism, of course, absolutely rife. Enshrined. It's enshrined in Parliament, my friends. When Derek Conway got caught a few years ago, about 2010, employing his family, we found out that at least two-thirds of MPs all employ their family and friends as researchers. And they employ a lot of mistresses and boyfriends as well, and they're kept off the boot because we don't know if they're, you know, related or not. But anecdotally, we do. What was the parliamentary response to this? Parliamentary response was, well, what we'll do is we'll make everyone sign a register and we'll just let them do it. None of this. Actually, nepotism and the public purse maybe shouldn't go together, and maybe you should stamp that out. And maybe that's actually a sign of very positive leadership for Britain. No, none of that. Just put your name in a book, it'll be okay. And that's what we do now. And the guy who championed this, who was the Standards and Privileges Committee chair at the time, it was his daughter who was his chief advisor as well. Crazy response. Another thing that comes under the idea of influence markets, you can't really say that very well, I'm sorry, is of course political party donations.
I can't vouch for any expertise in Australia, but all you've seen is, even though things have improved in this case in New Zealand and the UK, we've still got plenty of loopholes. We have donors clubs. In Britain, what I love is the leaders club. Someone got sacked from being the co-treasurer for the Tory party a few years ago. And because he was caught on camera saying, 125 grand donation, nah, that'll get you nothing. 250 grand, that's Premier League. That'll get you a meeting with David Cameron. Well, he was overselling it a bit. He was a car salesman. Because 50 grand gets you a meeting with David Cameron. Because that's all above board, something called the leaders group. You give 50 grand to the Conservative Party, you can have all the meetings you want with David Cameron. Again, your name will go on a register. No one will say what you've done, what you've talked about. But you can have your meeting for 50 grand, that's all it costs. Cabinet Club in New Zealand, shrouded in secrecy, but you know that a much smaller donation than 50 grand will get you dinners and meetings with the National Party leading members. Isn't that right, Michael? Okay, I've got 1 minute. It's right though, isn't it? Yes, it is. If I've libelled anyone, don't put this bit on the camera. And then finally, of course, we've got just the whole notion of kind of corporate hospitality. The whole industry of corporate hospitality. Some of the things that went down when we were bidding for the Olympics, when the UK was bidding for the World Cup, and we put a lot of lovely corporate hospitality. It was just bribes by another name. And this is what marketing of influence is. And it's something that really Australia and New Zealand and other developed world countries have to absolutely get to grips with. That it's all very well to say that we're doing okay because we're not developing nations, we're nowhere near as bad as others. That's not the point, is it? We have essential forms of bribery that we're not admitting to. And that we don't actually change in the law. I note that in Australia, along with even the changes in the law in New Zealand, we still allowed facilitation payments. That's a bribe by another name, isn't it? It's outlawed by the United Nations Convention Against Corruption. We still have them. What's our response? Write your name in a book. Put it on a register, it'll be all right. Okay? So, my good news is that Australia is a million times better than Britain. Seriously, I've got more good news, but I'm going to have to end you with that. But it is. It's probably against something you're already aware of, but hopefully it's good news anyway. I will leave it there. I do have a couple of extra slides. They'll be publicly available. Thank you.
Do you want to stay here? I found your notes. You were pretty good.
Oh, thanks.
Do you want them?
Not now.
Questions.
Go on then, yeah. Cheers.
Yeah. Chaos. Reigns supreme. Now I'd like to introduce you to Rob Ward. He's head of Leadership and Advocacy at CA. And we're going to have what I call in the tub session. So please welcome Rob. And thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Great. Well, thanks very much, Renee. And thank you, Professor Macaulay. It's quite interesting when you get an expert talking about something he's expert at. He's able to do what you just did, make it, really a terrific, it was a great presentation. Let me ask you a question, though, sort of on that. Why are you passionate about this? Why is this your life's work?
That's a really interesting question. I never set out to do this. I went through an academic route, but still not the one I expected to. And I don't know, but I'm from Middlesbrough and I'm from Teesside and we're always a bit chippy, I think. To the Northeast,
yeah,
because we know how unfair the political system is, and we know how undemocratic democracy is, and we know even now to this day that we have to put up with all sorts of stuff from London, and it just doesn't ever seem fair. It just never seem right, and it's never seemed fair that people who can get away with very, very, very high levels of misconduct can get away with it because of the positions they occupy, and because we set systems up to say, oh, actually, that's all right, it's not really a problem. And I was a magistrate for 7 years, and I saw people have to get punished who should never, ever, ever have been punished, who were being punished for social health issues, which was a disgrace. And I think it probably stems from that as well. And maybe because I'm short as well, because short people are meant to be kind of angry, aren't they? Although yeah. I don't think I am. I don't think I am.
But that's a good point. Like, are you angry about this, or are you just interested?
No, sometimes I actually get angry, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, which is ridiculous, really, because you shouldn't. But I can't help it.
No, you can't help it. It's quite fascinating, because as I was preparing for today, I'm pretty passionate about this as well, right? And in my particular career, I'm a PwC lifer, one of the accounting firms. And when I had my partners, when I was in New York being followed by the KGB, over a whole range of corruption issues, that you could have, I thought, this is pretty serious. These are my partners' lives at risk, and it was purely on corruption. So it's a really terrific topic, and I think it's important to us personally. People in the room here, a lot of you in the public sector, and probably like this, we look at the report, come back to that about the index and a number of issues. And I'm going to give the theme, I've got a bit of a theme here in, okay. in these questions. It's about the question of C. The C's all the way through this. So corruption. And Dr. Michael Fraser, one of my colleagues here, and I sort of worked on this together. We said it, we're looking for an annual thing. Are Australia and New Zealand corrupt? That's captured a lot of people's attention. They say, oh my God, what are you talking about? Corruption. Now you mentioned integrity, and you did touch on corruption.
Mm-hmm.
But what does corruption, and we define it here, when I say to you corruption, it means what?
In one word?
Yeah.
I couldn't do it in one word. Well, I mean, the usual thing on corruption is undue influence and misuse of authority for private gain. And that's as good an umbrella term as you can get for it. But it's more a case of not, I think, trying to find a blanket definition. You can't really do that for an abstract principle and get everyone to agree to it. It's about trying to drill down and say, actually, what forms of behaviour are we going to now say are corrupt or not? And the forms of behaviour that we identify as corrupt, your classic bribery kind of example, is prevalent in other nations far more than it is in New Zealand, Australia and the UK. But as I've alluded to, there are certain things which are perfectly legal, which to any other eyes would say, well, that is still buying influence.
Right.
That is still buying access. We don't really necessarily know just how much influence it might have until afterwards. But why should people be rewarded with a seat in the House of Lords for a political donation? Just why should it even happen?
It's interesting, isn't it? About how can you accept it? So look, we'll probably come back to that as we go through a number of these. I know I'm going to do a number of questions later on. But let me talk about the culture then of creating a culture. Now, you've spent time, obviously, your homeland, now in New Zealand, which is what slipped to number four, but we're going to talk about slipping in a second. How do you see culture shaped? How do you shape a culture around corruption? So take your homeland, take New Zealand, take Australia, China. How do you shape a culture?
Are you talking about national culture or are you talking about organisational culture?
Both levels.
Okay, well, national culture requires political will because the vast majority of people, and this is a ludicrous generalisation, but I would imagine the vast majority of people in this room here, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, would already and instinctively and well recognise that there are all sorts of corrupt things going on that they would love to see tackled. And the reason, primarily, that they don't seem to get tackled is through political will. We've got to have, like, the Bribery Act is a brilliant example, right? The Bribery Act really is the UK Bribery Act. It's quite severe. And it's beautiful in its simplicity. Four offences, you've done any of them, that's it, right? It's way, way, way better than it used to be. It's an incredible improvement. But where's the political will to try and implement it? Where's the political will? When there was the MPs' expenses scandal, that was 400-odd MPs ripping off taxpayers' money for moats and toilet seats and new curtains and fake mortgages. Where was the political will to actually do something about that? Well, the response was, we got encouraged to do it. We all thought it was okay. The closed system argument, we just thought that was the thing to do. We got advised it was the thing to do. And MPs really did get advised that was the thing to do. Where was the leadership? Where was the honesty to turn around and say, actually, it's not good enough to say, yeah, well, we've obviously made a mistake. It would have been a little bit nicer to be honest and say, actually, yeah, we fully accept that we've done something really bad with the public purse here and we're going to put a stop to it completely. And so it requires that, but in terms of organisational culture, it's about getting the entire integrity system ready. It's about making sure that the definitions and the values within the organisation are discussed and agreed upon. It's about having the correct form of leadership. It's about having proper forms of monitoring. And it's about a decent system of rewards and sanctions as well. And from my own experience and my own research, certainly this worked in local government. One of the big factors in turning local government on a much more positive scale was public participation as well. Actually get members of the public involved in this. And this is what happened in Britain over a 10-year period. Members of the public became members of the local standards committee, which was responsible for the values of the local council and some investigative powers and local hearings and things like that. And they were incredibly successful. Interestingly, of course, they were abolished as soon as the coalition government got in. But there you go.
Right. So, organisations, so number of public sector, probably a lot in the room here, who have their political masters. And I often think about this. I'm not from the public sector. I have great admiration for our public sector and our public service. I certainly do. The battle between a public sector and the political masters, what's your experience on that in dealing with the culture at the country level?
Well, this is where I think New Zealand is an absolutely fascinating example. The traditional idea is that we have political advisors who provide honest and open and free and frank advice, then we have politicians who make decisions, and then we have public managers who implement the policies that the decisions are being made on. And that's a clear and well understood and very long-standing distinction. And yet we know that certainly over the last few decades, it hasn't been quite as straightforward as that. There has been a regular case, again, I can't speak on particularly on the Australian side of it, but if this resonates, please do tell me, of political appointments, of people being made sure that the correct advisors are in place to give the advice that's wanted rather than the genuine advice that might be needed. And then the pressure on people to implement these things when they may think it's against the public interest. And what's really interesting about New Zealand is one of the big things at the minute that's going on in the country is the notion of stewardship. This idea of stewardship, a much longer view of kind of the what the public service is and can do and what the public interest may be. And that's actually been enshrined in law, that public servants need to engage in stewardship. It's been put in the State Services Act and also the Financial Services Act, and that's actually now enshrined in law. And what's really interesting is that actually legally shifts the balance of power into saying, well, at what point, and no case has come up yet, but at what point can a public servant or a political advisor say, actually, I'm working within my stewardship capacity here. I'm not going to do what's wanted of me. And I don't realistically actually think that will really ever, you know, come up. But it's there, and I think that's a fascinating thing, because the whole notion nowadays, we work in a much more collaborative framework than we used to do. The public sector isn't really just the public sector anymore. Public, private, non-profit, voluntary, we all work together. We all collaborate over just about everything in a variety of different ways. We have different cultures, we have different values, and they all interact, and that's a great thing, I think. But it does actually shift the idea of what it is a public servant's there for and how much independent power and authority they can exercise themselves. And that's just a question that we don't know the answer to.
Well, I'm sure it's very real in the room.
But
right?
It is.
Yeah, very real. So it's something we'd like you to take away as you think about this, as dealing with issues, because it's just not institutional, they're personal, all of these differences. So now let's look at culture. We're still talking about culture, and as you've seen them, you're a global guy, actually. You've operated at the UN and all this different stuff. And have you seen any country cultures that have changed with the political will? For the better or the worse?
I've got... When I worked with the Council of Europe a few years ago, and this doesn't end well, so spoiler alert. And I worked in Turkey, in Ankara. And because Turkey is undergoing potential European Union membership, they have to do all sorts of different things. And one of the things they have to do is really address some of the really quite endemic corruption that's taken place. And famously in Turkey, the most corrupt organisation is called the Land Registry. It's the biggest public sector organisation. Hundreds of thousands of employees. It's all over the country. Any kind of land deal or estate agency deal that needs to be done has to go through them. And what happened was that they were given the task of being the vanguards of anti-corruption in Turkey. And it wasn't just me who worked with them. Loads of people, different people worked with them. And they really did a brilliant job. It took them a good few years, 2 or 3 years, but they managed to change it at a root and branch level, as well as just the kind of, we're going to look like we're better. And they did it all sorts of ways. They did it by engaging the public. They used to have anti-corruption weeks in every single town, in every branch, so that people could come in and voice their concerns and participate and see what the Land Registry was doing. So there was that kind of outreach program. There was an entire performance regime was built with ethical and ethical competencies within it. So if people behaved more honestly, that was actually rewarded. Fantastic idea. And that was part of their continuous improvement. They had a new leadership structure. And they had a specific independent ethics committee and subcommittees all around the different regions of Turkey that would feed in with each other. They had a lot of symbolic changes. So you'd walk into any land registry building, you would see the values and the cultural values, and it was just, and it's a small thing, but it's a symbolic thing, and that's a cultural thing, and that's important. And they did all sorts of work, and they reported a massive, massive increase in public confidence. I don't think it was trust as much as confidence in their work. And of course, with the political regime and the turn that's taken, what happened was the ethics committee was, they were given notification about 18 months ago that if they wanted to continue, they had to join the political party. They had to join the government party, and they all went, well, we can't really do that. We're an ethics commission. And they went, well, forget it then. And it's taken a massive backward step. So I think that goes to show when political will's there, people are given the support that they need. Right. But when that political will changes,
yeah,
it can change very quickly.
That's interesting. So so that's a good news story and a changing story, right? So culture or is generally associated by not only ourselves, but those who we associate ourselves with.
Mm-hmm.
So Australia and New Zealand have differences, but we have a lot of things in common. And one of them is our largest trading partner, who probably doesn't have the corruption reputation it might like. Or maybe it does. Now, I won't say when you sleep with dogs you get fleas, but of that order, that if you're associated with those who might be perceived to be corrupt,
mm-hmm.
are you in fact being corrupt yourself?
Well, I mean, look, it's an impossible thing, isn't it? Because it's a political question, it's an economic question, it's a question of expediency and pragmatism. People aren't going to stop trading with countries such as China and other countries in the Middle East because of their human rights and corruption reputation. It's just not going to happen.
Correct. Right?
So we've got to work from that bedrock. So the question is, well, what do we do to kind of try and improve things? Well, the first thing is we make sure that our own reputations are as spotless as they can be. In order to do that, we've got to take the sty out of our own eye and recognise the things that we do currently
yep.
that are actually, you know, fall within that capacity. Because it's all very well saying, but we're much higher above them on the CPI, we're fine. Because, you know, that's just a self-reification. You actually need to be able to demonstrate that you're doing that. And then, of course, what you try and do is you will go through the classic ideas of trade and outreach, and you try and demonstrate how this is very important. I mean, I've had delegations from China come over, and we've done some fantastic training, and I've no doubt that they're going to do their best to try and implement some of the things that they've got from New Zealand. But they've got their own political culture and their own political masters to work with as well. So we've got to realise it's a very long step process. It's a very incremental process. It's a very evolutionary process. But it all fundamentally rests on how honest we're going to be about ourselves and our own capacity before we start saying, and we're going to tell you how to not be corrupt. Because that's cultural imperialism, and there's no place for it in this world.
That's, I think, absolutely right. And we've found with our Chinese friends, yeah, we have a standing there. They're seeking, you know, for their own advancement. I think they've been very constructive about it, and they're battling with it. So
well, I mean,
can we help them. Yeah.
Can I just pick up one final point there, sorry? I mean, when we have codes of conduct, don't we? Public sector codes of conduct, and they all have the great values in integrity, honest, trustworthy, reliability, et cetera, very good things. We don't often see values such as efficiency, which is in the Chinese public sector code of conduct, that we'll be as efficient as we can. Otherwise, that would actually be a problem of integrity, because it's contingent upon us to be as efficient as we can for the public of China. Why don't we have that value? There's things we can learn back as well. It's yep. not just it's not just a question of us lording it over people.
Absolutely. Okay, so I'm going to move on to the next C.
Okay.
Cost. So, you know, I think our research and other research from the firms and whatever say the cost of global corruption is about 5% of the world's GDP.
Something like that, yeah.
Something like that. So it's a pretty serious number. So if you're going to turn it up or down, it's probably going to move to 4% or 6%, et cetera. Jeffrey Watson, QC, SC, is a pretty prominent Australian silk.
Mm-hmm.
He's acted for ICAC on a number of cases, and he is very strong on the basis that we shouldn't measure the cost of corruption in dollars. It should be measured in human lives.
Mm. Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, there is the kind of the explicit cost that the World Bank like to promulgate, and they're bad enough. And I think the reason that's so important is because that's the type of cost that might appeal to a certain type of person.
Right.
Who look at the bottom line and go, actually, well, if that's what it's costing, then we may do something about it. But I mean, there's all sorts of brilliant work done on the Social Progress Index around the world about well-being nowadays. About social returns on investment, all of which show that it's not just about money. It's never just about money. You know, organised crime isn't just about money. When an organised crime leader's arrested, we'll find out how much millions they've stashed away and what they made and all the rest of it. But what we won't find out is how many lives were affected in a totally different continent. And it's another problem with things like corruption. It's a transnational, chain of causal events. You know, I mean, people trafficking that starts in East Europe ends up in Australia, ends up in New Zealand. We have absolutely no idea how many countless times people got paid and offered a bribe or what type of corruption happened along that way. It's an incredibly difficult thing to try and do, but all the time it adds to an overwhelming store of human misery. But let's be brutally honest about this. Forgive me for being idealistic. Wouldn't it be marvellous if the leaders of the world actually started looking at the world in terms of human suffering? Because then we might actually have some big decisions to change about an awful lot of things, quite frankly.
It certainly would, doesn't it? But it really does seem, though, we measure it in dollars, don't we, generally?
Well, another reason is because we're always using proxy measures for corruption.
Right. Yeah.
That's why. We don't know the extent of it. We can't know the extent of it. So we use the proxies that we can. We use perceptions. We use dollar values. And those things are useful as long as we just understand that they do have an inherent limitation. I mean, how else do we measure it? You can't measure it on conviction rates. There's a really interesting article that was published last month, and there was a couple of researchers in America looked at 18,000 different corruption convictions in America over 30 years, public sector. And the first thing I thought was, that sounds a bit fishy, because I'm sure haven't been that many. And when you look, of course, it's misconduct of various types. And what they discovered was only 2% of these 18,000 involved politicians and political leaders, and the rest all involved, you know, kind of frontline workers, street-level bureaucrats, and it was things like mail fraud or tampering with people's mail, things like that. Things that are clearly not really to do with high-level corruption.
Yeah.
And that just goes to show, well, if you're looking at convictions that, it's like saying, I'm going to look at murder rates or how many kidnappings have there been. You know, it's just, you're comparing apples with oranges, so no wonder you're saying that there's hardly any political corruption, because that's not what you're actually looking for, because that's not what gets convicted.
But it's a pretty good proxy measure, isn't it, people's lives?
Only four MPs ended up being convicted for the MPs' expenses scandal, 400 and odd.
Right, there you go.
What does that tell you?
Yeah. Okay, my next C, complacency. Now, I can look at this from different fronts, right? So we all know the FIFA clean out. I don't know about you, but how I felt, Kerry, how you felt, everyone else felt, I know they've been cheating for ages. We all knew that.
Yeah.
So why did we accept that? Why did it take 20 years for that to come out?
Well, probably because there is a lack of political will to do so, because there's too many other benefits. I mean, FIFA is just, it's absolutely staggering. I mean, we all know quite a lot already, but it's still only the tip of the iceberg. If you look at the bidding process for the World Cups that are now going to be held in Russia and Qatar, it was fascinating because FIFA put all sorts of stipulations on this about what FIFA demands and what FIFA doesn't demand. And what it demanded was things like complete and utter tax breaks, so there'd be no tax paid by any FIFA official and or their partners when they came over. There'd be no immigration checks and balances. They would automatically be granted visa for anyone, they said, was in the FIFA delegation. Basically, what they asked for was things that were completely illegal in every single one of the bidding countries, except Russia and Qatar, where it wasn't illegal at all. And what would have been fascinating is if England had actually won it. We'd have had to change, the European Union would have had to change its laws. Well, it wouldn't have done that. So we signed up to things we signed up making promises we just couldn't even keep.
I knew the FIFA one would get you started.
Oh, yeah, well.
But let me stay with complacency and bring it closer to home. So the latest Transparency International report, so at the end of January, Australia has slipped again.
Mm-hmm.
So the last 4 years, we've gone from 4th, 8th, 11th, 13th.
Yeah.
Now, the last time we fell out of the top 10 on a medal tally was the gold medal tally at the Olympics. And there was a national inquiry after that. And yet, we're now down to 13 and trying to get any interest. You know, I've produced some stuff, a few blogs, media aren't interested. So where will it take us to become, in terms of being complacent, that, you know what, it's not okay. 15th, 18th.
Yeah.
And it's more the trend that's important than the absolute.
Yeah, I mean, to a very large extent, I completely agree with that. But I think, again, there's always just a few notes of caution. So New Zealand has slipped from first to fourth, and it was very proud of being first, and it was first for a few years. But its score hasn't changed. Its score hasn't changed. What's happened is, so it hasn't really slipped, it stayed the same. Other countries, the Nordic countries, have made slight adjustments. And of course, next year, because New Zealand just put through all sorts of different, finally ratified the United Nations Convention Against Corruption, we put all sorts of little things in law to say we're going to do this, that, and the other to improve our bribery and corruption legislation, we might go back up. But when it comes to complacency and people not seeming to care, well, who doesn't care? You know, I'm surprised that the media doesn't pick up on this because the media loves bad news. And the public certainly seem to, in my experiences, always enjoy stories of political corruption and scandal because it's all what we think anyway. Not necessarily all of us. That was a ridiculous joke. You might not.
Yeah, it's interesting. We've got a number of op-eds out there, et cetera. Media just won't pick it up. I just don't understand why, but I'm challenging them on it.
Yeah, well, I mean, the question is who's complacent? That's the question. And complacency becomes the biggest issue when it's the people who can do something positive are the complacent ones.
Yep.
That's the problem. It's like the transparency paradox I was talking about. If you hear news you don't want to hear, you'd rather think, actually, we'll just ignore that completely rather than admit to it. Because then it will at least will look good. We'll look good. And we can just carry on living our lives. So the prisons will look good because no one's trying to escape. Fantastic. They're not realising that statistic is partly there because there's so much corruption going on.
Excellent. Okay, we're just going to do one more C, and then we're going to go to questions. So you start to get ready for questions, that'd be good. My last C, and this paper here, we've developed these in conjunction with partners, the firms, and this is from one of your colleagues
Indeed, Lisa.
In New Zealand, yeah, and she did a great job for us as we developed all this work. And we came up with 10 ways forward. So I was going to do a bit of speed dating here. Michael's ready for 5-word answers about how these 10 recommendations might live.
They're not going to be 5-word answers.
Okay, I could round it up to 15.
I'll try.
All right, one. Okay. Increase transparency in public sector contracts.
Yes, but sunlight may be the best disinfectant, but it often creates more shadows in which to hide, so it doesn't work by itself.
No public sector contracts for those with past convictions.
Well, some corruption convictions.
Any convictions.
I'm not sure that's workable. Any convictions, I don't know. As a magistrate, I would say, no, that's unworkable and unfair because it depends what the conviction is.
Okay. No public sector contracts for companies without corruption policies.
Excellent idea.
Increased use of asset confiscation.
Excellent idea, but I'd like to know how. Great in principle, difficult in practice.
Encourage anti-bribery and corruption policies and practices in the private sector.
So you say that one again?
Policies. Encourage policies in the private sector.
No-brainer.
This is an interesting one, which we won't explore totally, but rewards for whistleblowers.
Again, in principle, yes, but the experience of the reward system in America has been patchy at best.
Better cross-border cooperation on bribery.
Again, in principle, superb. Look, if we get that, then we're laughing. That is one of the absolute smoking guns of corruption. To get transnational activity, coordinate such a degree that we could have that kind of cross-border cooperation would be absolutely wonderful. I'd love that to happen.
Okay. Harsher sanctions applied more broadly.
Let's just apply the ones we've got first.
Right, yeah, that's so true.
It's meaningless.
I quite like this one. Limit tax deductibility of facilitation payments.
Facilitation payments should be banned. They're outlawed. They're outlawed under UNCAC. There's no place for them.
Do you have a view on that? Require anti-bribery and corruption policies in Australia and New Zealand listed public companies.
Well, yes, but they shouldn't be needed at this stage. People, that should already be done. You know.
Right. Okay, it's a standard. Okay, so what I'd encourage you to do is we're going to go to questions now. Have a good read of this. This is a 20-minute read and hopefully something you can discuss with colleagues with. So I think we have a couple of roving mics and start one down here with Kerry.
Hi, Michael. Kerry Jacobs, University of New South Wales.
Hiya.
I was amused being a New Zealander, New Zealand being rated number one in Transparency International. Joke was that was because they privatised all the public sector. So, you know, the two key assumptions of Transparency International, you know, one is, as you mentioned, the perceptual measure, and the second one is public sector and not including private sector. You know, how would you measure corruption if you could change it? And what difference would it make to include both public and private sector within that measure?
Well, if I could tell you how I'd effectively measure corruption, I wouldn't be here. I'd be on my yacht measuring it, you know. while I'm rolling around in my money bank, still being able to be generous enough to give the vast majority of it away to the people of the world. There is no ideal way of measuring it. There is no ideal way of measuring it. It's just as simple as that. And like I said, when I say take these things with a pinch of salt, I don't mean reject them. You know, I just mean take them for what they are. But when it comes to public, yeah, I mean, I've never understood that either. I told you we're doing this survey on trust, right? And there is a question that's asked on trust every couple of years. There's a national, you'll know it, the Kiwis Count survey. And they ask, how much do you trust? But the only question they ask is, how much do you trust the public sector? Well, that's a good question. But it's hardly really conducive to getting a genuine understanding of political trust in New Zealand. Because it is, you know, such a discreet area. So I honestly don't know what the difference would be if you included private as well as public. My instincts say it would probably be a more negative perception. But I don't know that, so I wouldn't predict it. But I certainly think it's time that we looked at that kind of idea. Because, I mean, when the CPI is broadcast, when the CPI is publicised every year, it doesn't really go into the fine details that it's just about the public sector, does it? We just go, oh, New Zealand's more corrupt because it's slipped down the list. Well, actually, New Zealand is exactly the same level of corrupt as it was 3 years ago. And that's only, as you say, the perception of the public sector. So it's a case of TI maybe promulgating the message a bit more. I'm sorry that they were two very waffly answers.
Others? Yep. Question down here. I don't know whether the mic.
On its way.
Here it comes. Thanks.
Having been responsible, not for corruption in a public sector organisation, but for stopping it, these things stand out to me very much as external things. People, this is about doing things to people rather than actually changing culture. For a person that's involved in trying to reduce or prevent corruption in an organisation, these things are things that are being done to organisations. I'd just like to comment on that and on the building of culture within organisations.
I think we touched upon that, and I completely and utterly 100% agree with you. And my good news last slide was going to be some of the kind of integrity system, inter-organisational integrity system measures that you can do. You've probably done them yourself, no doubt. And there is so much about cultural aspects of ethics and integrity that they really can't be ignored. Now, I can't speak for this report, but I would imagine that there's only so much can go into a report like this. And so, you know, maybe that would be another report. I don't know. But you're absolutely correct.
Maybe I could comment on that because I think it's a very good point. I think it's the acceptance of corruption, and certainly individuals do it to an organisation, no doubt about it. It's in the next step. The tolerance of that organisation in dealing with it, either accepting it, turning a blind eye, that creates the culture, right? So that's a really good point, that individuals do it to organisations, then organisations do it to themselves if they don't deal with it. And the FIFA one is the classic example, where they all knew they were doing it to them and so created this culture of acceptance and the flow-on effect. I don't know about you, but you know when you get one of these bad news stories about this stuff coming out, you get that terrible feeling in your stomach. You feel like it's been done to you, right, or done to us, that someone's just done us over. Someone we trusted, often in drugs, in sport, that's not quite on this, but it's the same thing, where you feel like someone's cheated you. And so it's a matter of how the organisation, and I probably have to say, we've got an example in tennis, going on now. It seems like the organisations are dealing with it much more rapidly. Sponsors stop. Maybe there is a response now that's becoming more institutionally accepted.
But it would be nice to have some institutional honesty and actually have some across-the-board idea of just how prevalent drugs in tennis is. Because there's a massive suspicion, I'm not saying it is because I can't, but there is a huge suspicion, isn't there, that extremely successful, wealthy tennis and athletes and everyone else, there's a vast layer of great usage than anyone's actually acknowledging.
Right.
Like as turned out to be the case in cycling, when it wasn't just Lance Armstrong who'd lied through his teeth and destroyed people's lives in achieving his 7 titles when he was cycling, But the people who come second and third were all drug cheats as well, weren't they? you couldn't award a first place because it would have been 167th. just the bloke in the car following him. He'd probably had a glass of wine, hadn't he, at lunchtime, to be fair, it was France.
Well, we're all laughing because we know that's true, right?
Well, we think it's true, don't we? I mean,
we do think it's true. So it goes to the point of what's the acceptance of that sort of behaviour. So, very good question. David.
I actually have a C question.
Yeah.
And my C question goes to conflict of interest. Chartered accountants have very high auditor independence rules, mm-hmm. which broadly say that if my partner becomes a CFO of an audit client, then I need to resign regardless of whether I've ever worked for that client. If I compare that, for example, to the political environment, say the CFMEU, an organisation that has been accused of corruption, a senior official whose brother is a senior political figure that regularly speaks on those matters, or if I look, for example, this week, Michael, a tell-all book published by a senior journalist that brings into question relationships with the former Prime Minister. I was a little intrigued to learn that her husband is an advisor to potentially a political opponent of that former Prime Minister. So my question is this. Have chartered accountants set the bar too high on conflict of interest? Or is it indeed the case, perhaps, that the journalists and our political leaders perhaps need to raise the bar slightly?
I can give you absolutely zero opinion, unfortunately, on chartered accountants, other than the fact you're all marvellous. Don't forget to put that in your feedback forms. I said that. I think the other bars are too low anyway. Conflicts of interest are really difficult, aren't they? I mean, I go back to the classic one. Hopefully too many people too old to remember this, but the Clive Ponting case in the UK, where he brought the Official Secrets Act to show that in the Falklands War, the battleship, the Belgrano, was sunk essentially illegally. And he got to court and he actually won the case. And the judge, that wasn't the outstanding feature of the story. The outstanding feature was the judge rewrote in his judgment that from now on, the public interest will be defined as whatever the government of the day says it is. So that just goes to show how incredibly low conflict of interest bars can be. And when it comes to professional ones, you've got all sorts of different ones, haven't you? You've got your own personal values with organisational values, organisationals with professional values with the kind of internal small-p political values that we have to kind of negotiate to all get on and work with each other. So I do think it's a case of conflict of interest need to be much clearer, but they can't be too stringent because then they just become another loophole you can hide behind, if that makes sense. I was within the letter of the code. Well, you can do a lot of things within the letters of the code and the law and get away with it all sorts of monkey business. But I'm sure yours is tremendous, but others definitely do need to be raised. Irregardless of whether yours is too high, others need to be raised anyway.
One more question, yeah. Can I just partly answer the question? But look, that's a really good question. And is our bar too high? It's high. And I've been subject to the auditor independence requirement, as we all have big time, some most ridiculously high. And you'd say sometimes they weren't practical. But at least we know what we're dealing with, you know. And I think one thing I can say I'm very proud of, the standing of the people in this room and their understanding of it. We seem to cope okay. We live a pretty good life, you know. I'd rather stay where we are rather than... It'd be a big announcement, wouldn't it? Chartered Accountants Australia and ANZ reduce ethical requirements for its members. That'd be good. OK, one more question. Time for one more. OK, last one down here, and then I'm going to ask Michael to wrap up with three messages, maybe.
Oh, OK.
Thank you.
Sam Robinson. Question more about anti-corruption practices. I guess the cost of any anti-corruption program, you know, can be prohibitive. And the cost of corruption, I was just flicking through the publication, is 5% of GDP. Should the cost, I guess in your view, is the cost of anti-corruption, should that be equivalent to the corruption level, i.e. should they balance each other out? Or should you spend as much as you can to get rid of all the corruption?
I've never done the study, and I'm not sure it actually has been done, but maybe it should be done if it hasn't. It probably hasn't, I probably just missed it. But the places to be able to identify those kind of costs and balances would be Hong Kong or Singapore, that obviously has instituted very successful and positive anti-corruption regimes. And it would be interesting to know how much they have cost and compared to how much that's saved, and that might give an answer to that question. But it does also go back to the question we were talking about in terms of dollar value and simple human decency and human lives. And I'm always struck by, I interviewed one of the former chairs of the serious organised crime agencies who ironically subsequently resigned because of corruption issues. I know. It's Britain, what can I say? And he told me that it was a really interesting analogy that when it comes to organised crime and corruption in particular, it kills millions and millions and millions of people, but we never hear about it. Terrorism kills a lot of people, but nowhere near, not even remotely near the same amount of people. And it's because, of course, that that has that kind of air crash, bang, kind of huge impactful story to it, whereas road deaths and traffic accidents don't have that impactful story to them, but there are far more of them, and they're far more endemic, and they're across the world. And I think we need to start thinking about it along those kind of lines, to be honest with you.
That's great. Thanks very much for that question. So, Michael, just before I wrap up, three messages for us.
OK, well, the three messages I've got in terms of organisational culture would be the first one, that it can be done. It can be done. It's not easy. It's hard work. And it requires an awareness and an understanding of a number of different issues all at the same time. And it also requires, in my view, and I'd be very interested to maybe speak with you after this, sir, it requires genuine consultation and participation of a range of people. It's not good enough just to say it's torn from the top and that'll be enough. It isn't that. It's about inclusion and getting people involved. And I've said the examples, quite a lot of examples from English local councils that did this. The successful ones are the ones who got people involved. So it can be done. That would be my first one. The second one, and again, I would have come onto this, so you can read the slides yourself to prove I'm not lying, is that morality and ethics and integrity are far more emotional than rational. We experience moral dilemmas primarily in an emotional way. You ask the question, why do I get angry? A very emotional, affective response. Mm. It's only afterwards you sit back and you rationalise to yourself. And this has frankly been denied by several thousand years of Western moral philosophy, and it's outrageous. It's taken until feminism, really, before we've actually started to try and wrestle with the idea that there are emotional content that we need to wrestle with. Now, the downside of that is, of course, emotions are far more easy to manipulate. But nonetheless, it's how we experience moral dilemmas. If you're a psychologist in the room that you aren't putting your hands up, read Jonathan Haidt and Drew Weston and all those wonderful, wonderful writers that are on the go at the minute. And my third message, well, I guess my third message would be just keep reflecting on yourselves. Your moral values will have changed, I'm quite sure of it. Mine certainly have. Social values have changed. Don't be frightened by change. You know, question it. And I think that will give even more confidence that your personal frame of ethics and personal codes of conduct that you hold internally are even stronger through reflection.
Well, that's a great way to finish. And before I come back and thank Michael, could I just do this in this order, to thank Renee, to you and your team for getting Michael here to start off with. And I don't know what you think of Renee, but I think she's fantastic running these forums and everything for us. And she's very innovative and passionate about all of this and getting people here. So to Renee and all your team, thank you very much indeed for all of this. Michael, it's great seeing somebody who's expert deliver something. You are expert. Mm-hmm. You can't say you're not. You're clearly passionate about what you're doing, and it makes a big difference. You know, chartered accountants, one of the things we do really is our ethics and our code of conduct, and David mentioned the conflict is foundation to what we do. Every time there's an attack on that, any time we have one of our members go off the rails, it's gut-wrenching, frankly. And then you have the political, you know, issues we have to deal with, etc. So we hold that very dear. Now, this is part of your life's work. And as experts often do, they can deliver it really well in a light and bring a human reflection on it. And that makes a massive difference. And and you slipped in and out of being very serious to being quite light about it. And I think it was just fantastic in that. We really appreciate you coming here today, for sharing your insight and experience. And on behalf of all of us, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Mike. Thank you. And, thank you, Mike.